In the last episode, we looked at the history of Western vocal music. So now, let's look at the instruments we have at our disposal. And yes, voices are definitely instruments, and should be thought of as such, as they have clear strengths and weaknesses when it comes to music making. In general, we divide singers into two groups, men and women. Women's and men's voices are pretty similar in terms of their timbre, or sound quality, but the lowering of the larynx in men when going through puberty means that men sing at a much lower comfortable pitch than women. And yes, we all know a guy with an extremely high voice who thinks of himself as a soprano. In this episode, we'll discuss the female voice. We initially divide female voices into two, a lower part and a higher part, and from there we can divide further in various ways. The higher part is usually referred to as the soprano part, and the lower the alto part. If you're wondering why we call them this, I talk about it in the previous episode. You don't have to use these words, but they're commonly used in the music realm, so you may want to use them to assure people that you're a professional and definitely know what you're doing.
Hold it! I need to make one clarification before we go any further. A voice part and a voice type are not the same thing. Also, some of you might be wondering why I haven't talked about mezzo-sopranos yet. It's not actually common to use a mezzo-soprano voice part in a choral score, but I will talk about the mezzo-soprano voice type in a later episode.
In the classical realm, voices are divided into a variety of categories based on their ranges and timbre, and this practice is called Fach, meaning specialty or area. They'll be called extravagant things like coloratura soprano, dramatic contralto, spinto tenor, and fat bass. While there's some limited use for Fach in the choral world, the fact of the matter is that it's not a very useful system for choirs, as Fach is intended to classify operatic solo voices, giving composers a way of communicating the kind of voice they want for a certain role in an opera. Further, operatic voices are trained to project their sound without any external amplification, like microphones. When arranging for choir, however, you will generally not be working with people who have spent decades developing the particular instrument that is the voice of an opera singer. And, of course, where most popular music genres and contemporary a cappella is concerned, microphones are usually used. So, the singers in your soprano section can fit within a variety of voice types, and you need to be aware that just because one soprano singer can sing a top A clearly and without straining, others may not be able to. You need to design each vocal line so that all your singers in a section can sing it easily.
As I like to say, exceptions don't make good guidelines.
So, let's get to the meat of the matter, and the real reason why you're watching this video, the ranges of the voice parts. First, the soprano part. Like I mentioned earlier, you need to differentiate between professional singers and amateur singers, as this will have a bearing on the ranges within which they can sing. Professional singers are going to be more specialized and usually have more training, though there are, of course, many skilled amateur singers as well. It's worth mentioning that professional vocal groups are rare, and most choirs are either amateur or semi-professional. A typical amateur soprano range will fall roughly between D4 and F5. More skilled, true sopranos can sing down to an A3 and all the way up to a stratospheric C6, also known as top C. As for altos, you can count on them being able to sing from G3 to about B4. With higher skill altos able to go down to a grumbling E3 and up to a powerful E-flat 5.
But Knut, I'm an alto, and I can sing up to G5. And this one time, I sang down to bottom C.
Well, these are sweeping generalizations about where people can sing. Between 7.5 billion people in the world, you can really only make an educated guess as to what their ranges are going to be. So you should think of these as helpful pointers rather than set-in-stone rules. Of course, nothing is going to be better than having intimate knowledge of what your singers can do. And it's actually really easy to find out. All you need to do is sit down with a few of them and do some vocal exercises, and you'll be able to suss it out.
So there you have it. Now you can make parts for female voices. Or, you know that there's more to this than just knowing the ranges of the sections. An important consideration when writing for voices is the break. The break exists in both male and female voices, and is the point at which an ascending line will naturally change from chest voice to head voice, and vice versa. Or, in the case of untrained singers, where the voice might crack.
It happens to the best of us.
Il nome mio nessun saprà.
Chest voice is the full, rich sound that voices have in their lower ranges, and is referred to as such because it physically feels like it's vibrating in the chest when singing. Head voice typically has a lighter sound, is used in the higher range, and is named for the sensation that it manifests in the head rather than in the chest. In the case of female voices, the break is usually around A4 or B4. You should know that the use of these terms is not completely accurate, as there exists several registers and breaks in the voice, but, at a lower level at least, they make sense and are easy to understand.
So, what does this mean exactly? Well, your higher female singers are usually going to be more adept at singing in head voice, so as they get into head voice they'll have great power and they'll have a lot of range going up. However, they might be a little bit weaker in their mid and lower ranges. Whereas your lower female singers are usually going to be better at singing in chest voice. And as they get higher, they might be reluctant to switch to head voice. Some singers are okay with this, like classical singers, they will usually just switch to head voice. Whereas your pop singers might instead use either a technique called mix or a technique called belt as they get into their high voice. These singing techniques used to be controversial, but these days they're quite common. Especially in the realm of musical theatre, belting is very important, and it really became so after Ethel Merman sang I Got Rhythm in the 30s. I thought it'd be interesting to have some singers come in and demonstrate what a soprano might sound like and what an alto might sound like. So I've got some of my friends here, and this is Therese, who I sing with in London Contemporary Voices. Hi, Therese.
Hi, Knut.
How are you doing?
Doing well, thanks, yeah.
All right, what have you done today?
So today, oh no, don't ask me on a day when I've not been busy. No. I'm always busy, that's my thing. Today I've been doing some writing.
Okay.
Because I am currently, what I've been doing lately is to work on a play. Because I, in addition to singing, I'm a writer-performer type person, so I like making shows and performances, and I recently took a play up to the Edinburgh Fringe, a play called Mission Abort. I won't go into detail about what it's about, but you can check it out. So I took that play up to the Fringe, and now it's basically a case of deciding where it's going to go next, which is very exciting.
Therese and I, we work together in several different situations, because we both sing in a lot of contemporary voices, and also... I wrote a couple of songs, which Therese is singing, and it's just piano and singing, but I was so captivated by Therese's voice, and I had to get her on the record.
As much as that feeds my inner diva, I think the main sort of the center point of these songs is the poems that they're based on.
Yeah.
So, because we found a bunch of poems by a fantastic Swedish poet called Karin Boyen.
Mm-hmm.
I showed these poems to Knut because she's not very known outside of Sweden, not even in Norway, which I actually didn't know. But this poet is from my hometown and recently went out of copyright.
Ooh,
so that's very handy. So Knut has put some fantastic music to these poems.
Now, which voice type do you consider yourself to have?
Well, oh, that's such a tricky question.
It is, isn't it?
I really hate that question. I think my voice type is probably the type that people assign to me for different projects. But probably, like, if I'm going to be completely honest, I'm a squeaky soprano. I was studying opera, it was coloratura soprano. So that was what I was going to be.
You'll find with singers like Therese, who've studied a lot of singing and have a great deal of training, is they will be able to do either part. They can do soprano parts, they can do alto parts. You could probably even squeeze out a bit of tenor if you had to.
That's what I was fishing for.
So, what are you going to sing for us today?
I'm going to sing one of your songs!
What's it called?
It's called Gudana, and that means the gods. And it's based on one of Karin Boye's poems, and Knut has just put a lovely, lovely melody line to it.
Okay. Well, let's hear the song then.
Yay!
So I'm here with Liv, who I sing with in London and Contemporary Voices. Hi, Liv.
Hi.
How are you doing?
I'm great.
Could you tell me about some things you're doing at the moment?
Sure. So I just recently graduated from LCCM.
Yeah, and that's London Centre of Contemporary Music.
Yes. Yeah. And I graduated with a musical directing degree, which is the same degree that you did.
Yeah, it is. We have the same teachers.
Yes. And that was really cool. It was hard, but I ended up doing well.
Now that you've finished with LCCM, what are you up to?
So basically, I want to be, and I'm working as a professional backing singer.
Mm-hmm.
And I sing a bit in a few bands, and I do all this work for LCV as well, London Contemporary Voices.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then I have other projects on the side, but my my absolute priority is backing singing. I love it.
So, Liv is gonna demonstrate the alto voice for us today. And what are you gonna sing for us?
I'm going to sing a classic standard, Misty.
Misty.
Yes.
Okay. Well, let's hear it.
Look at me. I'm as helpless as a kitten up a tree. And I feel like I'm clinging to a cloud. I can't understand, I'm too misty, just holding your hand. Walk my way, and 1,000 violins began to play. Or it might be the sound of your hello, that music I hear. I'm too misty whenever you're near.
Okay, so here are some other factors to consider. If you've got at least one very good, high female singer in your group, she can sing the top notes in your arrangements as a solo. Since no other voice parts will interfere with the sonic space, she will be heard clearly over the top. I recommend making this split around F5, as some singers will start to struggle when singing above this note. By the same token, it's better to avoid using the altos in their extreme low range in a mixed choir setting, as they will be intruding on the men's sonic domain and easily drowned out. Try to keep them at B3 and above in an SATB setting, unless you really know what you're doing. However, in an all-female situation, you can let them sing down in the basement, as my singing teacher would say.
So now we've covered the basics of the female voice. There are certain things I haven't talked about yet, like I haven't talked about special vocal effects or timbre manipulation. That stuff I'll cover in a later episode.
Knut! When are you going to talk about chipmunk voice?
And chipmunk voice. Let's not forget about chipmunk voice. I'll talk about that in a later episode as well.
Yeah!
So join me for the next episode where we'll talk about the male voice, and then we're going to start getting into the actual arranging process.
Subscribe.